All right. Well, before we begin, I just want to pray because tonight is it's got some good stuff that I feel Father wants to share with us. So, Holy Spirit, I invite you tonight into this message, into this meeting. I invite you tonight into the activations to engage with people's hearts and to give everyone here tonight and those who are listening a deeper revelation of your mystery, of your glory, of your passionate love for us. And may we go deeper in the realms of your kingdom and spirit tonight. We open our hearts to you, Holy Spirit. Minister to us with greater wisdom and glory. Amen. Awesome. I'm just going to hit mute for everybody. I can see some of you are still unmuted. I don't actually know how. But if you can mute yourselves, that would be great, just to save distractions coming through. Here we go. Great. So tonight is looking through. If you want to read the Bible afterwards, it's all based on John chapter 12. So before we begin that, I've got a special announcement. So this is for those who are coming into the free sessions. So there's a free sort of part of this evening. This is the first half. A lot of people come for that. So if you're listening or yourselves here tonight, or it's for those who are on the mentoring track as well. So I've got a few people that I'm walking a bit closer with, and we're going to they've actually all agreed to offer prophetic words for the next season. For those who feel as though they could actually do with a bit of encouragement from God. So, what is the purpose of this prophetic offering? Well, it's for those to practice their what they've learned through these mentoring sessions, to engage with God in a deeper way and to listen to Him in the deeper ways that I've been training them in, to bring a prophetic word. And it's they're going to listen over the winter season. And the word will be offered in preparation for the new year. Now, why is the new year such a key time? Well, there's nothing magical or special about it, actually. It's just quite biblical that the new year is spiritually, there's a lot of background to it, but at the time of the turning of the year, it's kind of set by God as a time and season for us to mindfully and spiritually turn away from the old and turn into the new. So it's to be placing ourselves before the Father, of turning away and turning into the new. So it's continually pressing in to everything that God has for us. And it's kind of a time of reflection that we can set ourselves aside for. And sometimes it's really helpful to have a prophetic word to lean on and to weigh into those. Into that reflection. So, if you're here tonight, or if you're listening, and that sounds like something you'd like to volunteer for, you can send me a message or comment below. If you're listening on YouTube, if you're on Patreon, send me a message. If you're here through a friend, let them know. And you can send me an email as well. The email, the best one to get hold of me, I'll type it in and I'll spell it out. It is Christian Seer. mentoring@gmail.com. So that's Christian Seer mentoring@gmail.com. And I'll spell that. So it's the word Christian, then Seer is Seer, and then the word mentoring. So that's all one word at gmail.com. So get in touch if you'd really like to receive a prophetic word. We have a limited number of slots and it's first come, first served. So, without further ado, let's move on with this evening. So, at the beginning of John chapter 12 is a really kind of famous message. You'll hear it time and time again in the church. It's where Jesus has his feet anointed. And we may well know this. It's when Mary anoints him and with some expensive perfume, she anoints him and he says it's for his death. But what I want to do is go deeper into this, go deeper into what the Bible is actually telling us in the deeper mysteries, in the symbolism of the words used, of the numbers, of the times and seasons mentioned. So it begins, and the Bible is very specific, 6 days before Passover. Now, this is often overlooked, and we often think, okay, so it's before Passover, great. What's significant about this? Well, it's so easy to look over this, but actually, the spiritual meaning of the number six represents the number of mankind. And as we'll see a little bit later, when the Bible mentions day, now it's different to what it mentions here as days, but it's kind of a play on words. Day, when the Bible mentions day, such as in the day of the Lord, or the day of the year of the Lord's favor, these are words used to express a period of time. So reading between the lines here, we have an era of mankind before the Passover. Do you get that? That's where this is starting. It's setting us up to say there's an era of mankind before the Passover. And this represents the season people were in. All of mankind was in before Jesus Christ. They were waiting for that Passover, so to speak. And Jesus himself says that he is the Passover lamb. So it's the state of humanity. Now, if we consider the parallel with Israel, that says that before Passover, they were in Egypt. They were in bondage, captivity. It was spiritual death. They needed salvation. They needed the Exodus to get them out. And that's kind of what this passage is portraying here, is that actually it's in a season of mankind before Passover, which is the season of death and bondage to sin. And the Passover is significant because it's when the lamb was slaughtered for the freedom of the Israelites. And so with parallel here, the Passover that's coming, the great Passover of Jesus Christ, is the slaughtering of Jesus, who John described, John the Baptist, as the lamb that takes away the sin of the world. So this is a prophetic act here, right on this time. The season is specific. It's the sixth day. There's a reason all this is happening on this day. God is saying, hey guys, this is a prophetic mystery. But as we'll see a bit later, their eyes were still blind to what was going on. So this is prophetic of Jesus's death being the Passover that saves us from slavery to sin and death. And you know, what's even amazing here is Jesus was anointed in the context of a dinner in his honor. So this is a place of honor when God prepares for the salvation of all the earth, for the redemption of all things. He's doing it in a place of honor. He's honoring his son. This is another sort of sign here saying, actually, this context of dinner in Jesus's honor is a reflection of actually heaven holding Jesus in honor. And his feet were anointed. And you may ask, why were his feet anointed? Jesus says it was to prepare him for his burial, for his death. But surely, if you're going to prepare a body for death, you anoint all of the body. You embalm it, you even fragrance the body. And it's usually after the body has died. But here we have it beforehand. What is going on here? Well, you see, if you think about it, if you think about the scriptures, it says that Jesus was the lamb slain before the foundation of the world. Jesus was kind of already counted as slain before the foundation of the world. So in a sense, because he had already made that decision, he was already prepared. His spirit was prepared. Everything about him was prepared to die, to save us. And so now this final embalming, anointing kind of preparation is happening, but only on his feet. And there's a reason why. If we expand the scriptures in Isaiah, which says, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. And Ephesians, it says that we need to ready ourselves with the armor of God. And it tells us to clod our feet with the sandals of the gospel of peace. So you see, there's something about Jesus's feet that actually signifies that his death is the bringing of this good news, the bringing of the gospel. And so that's what is going on here on a deeper level, is God is saying, hey guys, you're in captivity. Jesus is the Passover lamb. He's going to free you. And I'm holding a banquet of honor because I'm so pleased about this, because I've been waiting eons to reveal this mystery to you all. And the Bible even says that angels have not been permitted and are still not permitted to look into this mystery. And here is God revealing the mystery before us all in the gospel. And that's why there is such honor and such holy pride from God the Father to his son, Jesus. So now we get this picture of Jesus being anointed on his feet. And I want to turn that around to say, actually, we're no longer in that place where we're waiting 6 days before Passover. We are after Passover. We've received the Holy Spirit. We're in the kingdom of God. We're in that context of the dinner of honor with Jesus. We sit at the table and a banquet is placed before us, just as it says in the Psalms. Your cup is filled to overflowing and your head is anointed. And the oil drips down from God the Father, pouring upon you in honor. And I want to bring you now into an activation into that place to receive a washing of your feet from Jesus. It's kind of a reverse of what happened to Jesus. And we also see in the Gospels later that he washed his disciples' feet. And so in the Spirit, I want to lead you in an activation to allow Jesus to wash your feet, which is symbolic of how you take part in his death and his glory and his resurrection. So how this works is I'll encourage you in a moment to close your eyes and connect with God. And I'll lead you through some prayers which you can speak aloud or speak in the quietness of your heart. And I just encourage you through this activation to engage with God. So where you are, let's just take a moment to acknowledge the love and honor of God upon us now. Thank you, Father God in heaven, that you honor us. You have brought us to a dinner in honor of Jesus and in honor of us as your children. Now in your hearts, repeat these words or out loud. Holy Spirit, I love you. Father in heaven, I love you. Jesus Christ, I love you. And now as we continue through, I encourage you to open your heart, and if it helps, open your hands towards God. And reach out to him in your heart and say, Jesus, bring me into the heavenly realm, to a comfortable place where you want to wash my feet. And allow the Spirit of God to carry your senses and your spirit. Open your heart to the light of heaven and the presence of Jesus Christ. Hear the sounds of the honoring and the joyous festival and banquet set before you. Now in your heart, ask Jesus to wash your feet and see what the Holy Spirit shows you. And during this time, say to Jesus, what part of your glory Are you showing me? Allow him to minister deep into your heart. We're going to wait here for 5 minutes, and I'll call you back when the 5 minutes are over. Okay, when you're ready, thank Jesus for this encounter. And come back into the Zoom meeting. Just give me a wave or a symbol to me that you're back. Everyone's back. All right, just typing a message. How did you all find that? I think you're all on mute still.
Yeah, personally, I found that pretty good. When I asked what aspect of his glory he wanted to show me, I just sensed it was humility.
Wow. That's incredible, because he is the humble servant, isn't he? And that's the heart of it. The greatest among you will be the least. That's beautiful. Thanks, John.
Oh, yeah, thanks.
That's great. It's okay if you don't want to share as well, just by the way.
I saw a lot about the bowl of water because it was full of like rose petals and lemon and mint and thyme, and it seemed to have come from a stream in this meadow. But the aspect, I was behaving a bit like a toddler, like I want to do it myself, sort of thing, and not. And it made me aware of other things where I want to do it myself rather than let Jesus. So the aspect I picked up of his glory was his lightheartedness, because he was laughing. But it did seem relevant that I had been letting sheep and goats lick food off my hand this week, which is quite brave, and yet I didn't feel like able to let Jesus wash my feet, really.
How does it feel after that encounter?
Well, I just realize how silly I am, you know, in a way. It's okay, because he was sat beside me laughing.
Yeah. Wow. That's so, so amazing. And I think the symbols that you saw, the rose petals, and you said thyme, the herb, is it the
yeah.
herb? In the
yes.
in a bowl of water?
Yes.
Yeah, those are really interesting, because rose petals, the flower rose, is actually the rose of Sharon. It's a symbol of Jesus, and if they're just petals, it means that actually they've fallen off the rose because it's died. And then thyme was used as a funeral herb, so it's almost like he's giving you a bowl of water which represents life, that actually the life and the death of Jesus, that is so. There's a fragrance of life there, which is what the Bible mentions. And I wonder if that's the mystery of the glory that he's sharing with you, is actually there is life in
yeah,
this.
it's definitely about creation
Yeah.
Aspect. So life, yes, is so.
It's
Thank you.
amazing. Thank you, Susan. That's great. All right. Shall we move on? Just give a few moments. I don't know if you're wanting to share. I think you're on mute.
Yeah. Like I say,
good.
Sorry, I'm new to all this, really. Not very good at it.
It's
Thank
okay.
You. Do you still hear me okay?
Yep.
I would like to share, because I'd really appreciate your opinion on it. I'll try and make it as quick as possible. It was quite lengthy, really, but it wasn't so much with you saying about his glory. It wasn't so much a matter of my feet, although it started as that and it felt lovely. But then it's like as if he spread out. It was almost like a cloak, but then it seemed like white, might have been white wings. And in one of them, there was an eagle just tucked inside, but I could see it. And then the other side, there was another animal. I wasn't sure if it was a sphinx or a lynx. And then there was a lion. So it was all, these were all in like this cloak or the wings. And then I thought, goodness, it seemed like a giraffe's neck. And I thought, well, that doesn't seem very biblical. But then I got the impression of Noah's Ark. But that seemed to be something separate, because then came back to the eagle again. And it's like that turned gold. And then I saw the lion went turned gold. And then there was a lamb, and that was slain. But then it came about that it wasn't, it was as if it hadn't been slain. It was like restored. And then that turned gold. And then Jesus was like, you know, he was this brilliant white, and with this even his face seemed gold. So quite involved and most unexpected, all of that. So, but it kept coming back mainly then that it finished off by being, the eagle seemed to be featuring quite strongly, and that was gold, and the lion was gold, and the lamb was gold. So that was my final impression.
That's amazing. There's quite a lot of biblical imagery going on there. And so as I mentioned them to you, you'll probably think, oh, yes, I recognize those symbols. So, of course, the lion and the lamb, both symbols of Jesus, the Lion of Judah and the Lamb of God, being the triumphant king that he is, Lion of Judah, and the Lamb of God being the sacrifice. And the lamb slain is mentioned twice before the foundation of the world, but also the lamb that had been slain seated on the throne of God. It's another image of Jesus. After his crucifixion and resurrection glory, he sat down at the right hand of God. So what you're seeing here are both sides of Jesus, the king of all the creation, the lion, and the sacrifice that saved us and redeemed us, the lamb. So then it turns to gold. We'll come back to the turning to gold later. And then you see, you begun with seeing wings, eagle's wings, and many animals were also flashing before your eyes. You thought of Noah's Ark. That speaks of a deliverance. Again, it's a symbol of Christ and his deliverance for us. So it's a salvation, basically. It's this kind of symbol of the coming salvation in Christ. So what you're seeing here is actually the glory of God that he's revealing to you. The secret is in the two symbols, the lion and the lamb, but also this eagle. What is an eagle biblically? You'll find it in various images in the Old Testament. Psalm 91 may be very interesting, talks about under the shadow of his wings. It is picturing God as an eagle with wings that cover you, wings that cover the young underneath him. But the eagle is a symbol of the prophetic. So the eagle is in the book of Revelation. It's one of the living creatures. It's one of the faces of God that's represented, and it represents prophetic. So the glory he's sharing with you is actually a prophetic anointing upon you to journey into that side of God. Now, gold, why gold? Gold, biblically, means the covenant of God. So what is prophecy? The testimony of Jesus Christ is the spirit of prophecy. So it's no wonder you're seeing the images of Jesus in, and it all turns into gold representing covenant. It's all wrapped up in the new covenant. Does that make sense?
Well, I'm sorry, but because of my condition, I go a bit blank sometimes. So I got a bit lost after you said about the anointing of prophecy. I'm so sorry.
Well, if that's all you got, that's perfect. Because that oh. is, yes, I was just unpacking it all, but that is what it comes down to.
Mm-hmm. Right. I think you said something about the gold, though. It was a covenant, wasn't it, you said?
The new covenant, yeah.
So is were you saying that's a promise of the prophecy, then?
It's an invitation from God for you to explore the gift of prophecy.
Oh, wow. Can I say yes now to that? Yes. Yes, please.
Awesome. Great. Thanks so much for sharing.
Oh, thank you so much. I didn't expect such a wonderful interpretation because Susan would probably share with you, when I do have pictures, they seem so unusual. I sometimes wonder if it's me and not the Lord, you know. So thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
Do I need to leave you now and let you?
No, we've got one more thing to go through before the end of the free session.
Oh, so lovely.
The next section on glory.
Thank you very much.
So after this session, we also have one more activation. So glory. Glory is also mentioned in the latter parts of John chapter 12. And it starts with Jesus on the next day. So it's a new day. He arrives at the city and he's fulfilling prophecy. It says, "Your king is coming seated on a donkey's colt." And you know, the New Testament kind of quotes prophetic words like this, but never includes all of them. And it misses the middle part. The king arrives righteous and victorious, which is really fascinating because the glory of God is sealed now. And we see that much later when the Father speaks from heaven. And he says, "I have already glorified my name, and I will glorify again." It's like Jesus is entering into the fulfillment, and it's sealed and it's done. And this is the victory. At first, the disciples were blind to understanding the meaning of all of this. And even in the previous section we looked at, they were blind. They could not understand it. But it was when Jesus was glorified, their hearts were opened and they understood. You see, the glory of God opens the eyes of our heart. It is his glory that enables us to see and understand his mysteries. It's when Jesus was glorified, when he ascended into heaven, that the power to free us from all that binds us in darkness, it was released from heaven. It's the Holy Spirit. And there may be times when you feel like, oh, I just can't connect with God. I just can't hear from God. Or you just feel something is almost like blinding you or holding you back, restraining you. And often people ask, you know, what can I do to connect with God? What can I do to shift off this almost stagnancy and resistance? And one of the secrets is really hook into the glorified Jesus. Hook into the glory of God. Cast your spiritual gaze onto the risen, glorified Jesus Christ, because it's his glory that opens the eyes of your hearts. The light that shines from his throne blows away all darkness that prevents us from seeing truth. You see, God reveals the secrets of his mystery, the secrets of his kingdom, by the power of his Holy Spirit, full of joy. So if we lack wisdom or understanding, all we need to do is ask, and God will give it in abundance. From his glory, he gives us vision. So I've got an activation for you to encounter the glory of God. It's a glimpse of the risen Jesus Christ in glory. And to set the tone for this, I want to tell my testimony. So when I first met Jesus is when I became a Christian. I did not know Jesus. I did not know anything of Christianity. But something in my heart said I needed to cry out to Jesus Christ for salvation of my soul. I knew without him, I was pretty much going to hell. So I cried out. I said, Jesus Christ, if you are the Son of God, save me. And to cut a long story short, the next thing I knew, I was standing in the throne room of God, surrounded by light. And I could see many angels around me. And in the middle, on a throne made of light, was one who was so big and so tall. He was so full of light, brighter than the sun. And his light shone and lit up the entire place. And then I realized he was the source of all light. And as he stepped towards me, he held out his arms and wrapped them around me. And he said, I am Jesus Christ, the Son of God. I love you. I forgive you. And at that time, I received inside the Holy Spirit in heaven, and I was full of peace. And I suddenly knew Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is alive. Jesus is in heaven. All the stuff that just blinded me was gone in an instant as I beheld his glory. So this activation, I want to lead you to open the door into that place of encounter with the glory of God. So where you are, I just encourage you to enter that place again to encounter God. If you feel comfortable, close your eyes and reach out in your heart to Jesus Christ and echo those words, Jesus Christ, Son of God, meet with me. Lord, I am willing. Bring me into the depths of God. Bring me to the place your glory dwells. And now allow Holy Spirit to carry you. Allow the glory of God to enter your heart. And I'll leave you in that place with Jesus for 10 minutes. Allow his glory into your heart. Okay, when you feel able, give Jesus thanks for this encounter. And come back into the Zoom meeting and just give me a wave or a nod to let me know you're back with us. Right, that's everyone. How did you guys find that? I think you're all muted if you'd like to unmute.
I'll be honest, Lee, I found that one a bit harder. I kind of connected, then disconnected. Then reconnected, then disconnected, then reconnected. So overall it felt very peaceful.
Mm-hmm.
But there's not a lot I can say about it other than it was quite peaceful when I was connected.
Yeah. That's cool. Thanks. Thanks, John.
There seemed to be fire raging and things snapping at me on my left, but then I noticed there was a lion walking along beside me, which was Jesus, like protecting. And you just, I wasn't scared of him, but there were flames. Well, there were some flames ahead that were good, but there were others that I wasn't sure about. And then there seemed to be an invitation to get onto his back, which I did. And then it seemed like he was jumping on something. And I have a feeling it was myself. So I was on the back. It was jumping on my will or dead self kind of thing. Anyway, after that, it seemed like I was raised up onto a ledge high up, like, you know, placed me on a rock higher than whatever in that psalm. And it was like then I was shining with the glory. And it was like I was one with Jesus for a just it, which really felt just like that peace that John said. But I could see the shining, and it was just so just peaceful. And thought, this must be what it's going to be feel like to become one with Jesus, you know. Yeah.
Thanks, Susan. It's really encouraging. You've both said peace. You had peace, because when you get into that glory of God and you start to just receive it and engage with it, it does. Peace is right in the core of God. It's a peace that surpasses all understanding, as the Bible describes it. And Susan, what you've described is what I was saying, that as you get into glimpsing the glory, the things that are there that try to hinder you, sometimes they don't want to let go so easy, but they have to. So what you're describing could be that actually Jesus is putting them to your side. They're no longer in front of you, so you can press forward into that glorious place he needs you to be. Thanks for sharing. Christine, did you want to share anything? You're on mute again. I'll just ask you to unmute there.
Is that better? I will get the hang of this eventually, sorry. Yes, again, it was a bit involved. The first bit, it was unexpected. And so again, I'm not sure if it's of the Lord, but it was as if when I invited him into my heart, it's as if my heart was like, almost like a, I don't know, maybe a football or a balloon that expanded. It was white. and it expanded into like a room, and like then it's as if his angels came in, or someone came in, all with different tools, doing repair jobs, and like one might be welding and one might be using a jet washer and to target certain areas, and one might be doing some mending. But then certain places in this heart room needed Jesus' special touch, and he used a special tool in these special areas. But then when they'd finished, the whole room didn't look as it looked as though it was invisibly mended, as if there'd never been anything wrong. And then I felt a real tight feeling on my head, and I got the impression of it being like the enemy had put like a cast iron helmet on my head, but Jesus was prizing that off. But then it was as if there was still like a membrane on my head, almost like a skull cap, which was also of the enemy, I think. And it's like that was then lifted off. And then it was like I had luxurious hair underneath, glossy, and it was dark actually, but it's glossy, dark hair, luxurious hair underneath. So, and I think, as far as I remember, that was about it. But I felt that I got the impression that the Lord was doing a work, but that's not what I expected when you said about inviting the Lord's glory in, didn't you?
Yeah.
But so I don't know if that was me or...
It makes sense, because when the glory of God comes, he wants to beautify. And if there's stuff in the heart that needs beautifying, he'll restore it to his glory. Oh, so right. It makes perfect sense.
Does that?
Yeah.
Oh, good.
Him restoring areas of your heart into the glorious image that he wants you to be.
Oh, lovely. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing. That's awesome. That's all we have time for on the free section tonight. So thank you for coming. It's good to see you. And
thank you so much.
You're welcome. John and Susan, we've got one more section to go through. It's a little bit of a short one, but it's really important. It's what happens when prophecy comes and the spiritual dynamics thereafter. So we're going to look a little bit into that. Just great to see you. So let's have a little break for 10 minutes and come back at 10 past 8. Is that cool? Thank Is you. That long enough? Too long?
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye, Christine.
Bye-bye. Thank you. God bless.
Great. 5 minutes works perfectly well for me. I don't know how.
Five, yeah.
Yes, 5 minutes is good.
Great. Okay, I'll see you in 5.